Hello and welcome to eDiscovery Day. We're having a lovely webcast for you this morning, this afternoon. 10 years forward, 10 years back, automation in eDiscovery. This is a group that has been presenting together on this topic through the last few months at various conferences, particularly the Masters Conference, and we had such a wonderful response to it that we are bringing this in its entirety for eDiscovery Day. And we have a stellar group of presenters. My name is, I'm not the stellar one, but my name is Mary Mack. I'm the Executive Director of ACEDS, the Association of Certified eDiscovery Specialists. We're a sponsor of eDiscovery Day. And we have with us David Horrigan, who is the eDiscovery Counsel at KCORA. Many of you have been reading his blogs over the years, and David is quite the expert and a former analyst. We have George Socha with us. George is, among other things, a former litigator and the co-founder of the EDRM. And without the EDRM, I'm sure we wouldn't have an eDiscovery Day. He is now a managing director at BDO. We have Doug Austin, who is the VP of Professional Services at Cloud9. And Doug also works with clients to optimize their eDiscovery activities and spend. And he blogs daily at the eDiscovery Daily blog. We have Bill Dim, who is the founder and CEO of Hot Neuron, and Bill is one of the leading experts on artificial intelligence as it applies to law, and we're just thrilled to have him with us. And we have Bill Sparrows. Bill is a consulting attorney and in electronic evidence, and he's been laboring in the fields for years and has a marquee client list, including diving deep into the Madoff mess from an eDiscovery standpoint. And so all of these folks are going to talk with us about technology in the in eDiscovery. So from EDRM to four generations of eDiscovery, we're going to get into technology-assisted review. And unlike other presentations on technology-assisted review, people will actually disagree with each other. So that'll be quite interesting, I think. And we want your questions. We want your comments. So you can type them into the little box there at the bottom of your screen. And if it applies to what folks are talking about in the moment, I will interject. If it's something either forward or back, I'll wait for either the end or as the topic comes up, and I'll interject at that point. And to answer the question that everybody wants to know, will they get a copy of the presentation? Absolutely, they will get a PDF of the presentation, but what you're going to see here is includes some slide builds, some animations to illustrate some very difficult technical concepts to be able to communicate that in a quick visual way. So I would encourage anyone who is getting the presentation and forwarding it to people that they should definitely let them know that the listening and watching the presentation is the way that they're going to get the most out of it. That's not the case for many webinars. You can sort of listen to them in the car when you download them. This is one you're going to want to see the visuals of. So, yes, I did the introductions instead of the outline, but here we go. The let's not forget the disclaimer, and the disclaimer is that we'll be talking about hypotheticals, and the ideas expressed here are not necessarily those of our clients or employers, and are simply representing ideas intended to be helpful in the context of this seminar. They're educational ideas, and nobody wants to give away client confidences. So without further ado, I'd like to turn the presentation over to George Socha. We're thrilled to have you, George. Thanks so much for making time for us on this eDiscovery Day holiday. 10 years back, 10 years forward, George Socha.
Thank you, Mary. And for you in the audience, you're going to hear a lot of nexts from me, because Doug Austin is actually operating the slideshow, and I'm going to keep telling him to go next, as in right now, go next. So we're talking 10 plus years back, and then at least a few years forward. And I'm going to go through a quick overview of innovations in eDiscovery that have led us get to where we are today vis-a-vis automation. And then some thoughts about where we look like we are going into the future. So another next. So we start in 1987, 88. That is the year that two of the early and for a long time widely used programs for automated litigation support were introduced, summation and concordance. Why do they matter here? Two reasons. They became some of the earliest programs to be used for handling electronically stored information, and they also set the foundation for the load files, DAT files and the like that we continue to use today, and without which we would not have the type of automation we have in eDiscovery. Next, 1991. That, or thereabouts, was the year that image files, scanned images of documents, were first delivered on CD. Before that, you had to get them on a worm platter, which meant that until then, it was a cost-prohibitive activity. Once images were available on CD, they could be loaded into a machine or a box attached to a machine, and instead of pulling up a record and then go scrambling for a piece of paper or wait for someone to dig it out of the file room, you could look at the record, pull up the associated image, look at it, and refine your search. All could be done on a standard PC. A huge step forward, which sets the framework for the conceptual framework for converting ESI into either TIFF or PDF images and using those in the same way that the scanned paper images were being used on CD and then later right on hard drives. Next, we'll jump ahead a few years. 1997, Guidance Software was founded. Why do we care about Guidance? They were one of the providers of the earliest of tools used to preserve and analyze ESI. They came to us more out of the law enforcement arena, and originally they didn't even see their technology as having application in the world of civil litigation. But of course, that changed considerably. And then if we go to the next, 2003, Discovery Cracker was introduced. Discovery Cracker was one of the early tools used for processing electronically stored information. So if you were using Guidance Software's tools in, say, 99 or thereabouts when I was using them for eDiscovery, you could pull data in, you could search for it within their software, but there weren't really provisions for getting the data conveniently out of there and into other tools, such as concordance or summation. Discovery Cracker made that type of approach viable. Then, to my favorite, in 2006, January 1st, 2006, if I recall correctly, we introduced the first version of the eDRM diagram. You can see it's changed a bit over time, but it provided the first widely accepted, or eventually widely accepted, framework to explain what electronic discovery was at a conceptual level, and to break it down from one single thing. We got to do a lot of eDiscovery stuff to a group of more manageable steps. Moving from there, 2009, KCURA introduced its relativity ecosystem. So you can see I've jumped over a lot of things along the way, but these are just some highlights. Why this year? because it was the first time that one of the review platform providers opened up their platform to developers and allowed folks to build on additional tools to do things that the designers of the software themselves might not have thought of. And it opened up things for possibilities in a way we hadn't seen before. Then we go to 2010 with Recommind introducing both the concept of predictive coding and that catchphrase, which really caught on. Every few years we get a phrase that catches people's attention and imagination, whether it's early case assessment or predictive coding or a few others. This brought the attention of a technique that was fairly standard in other arenas to the world of litigation and e-discovery with predictive coding, which we tend to call technology-assisted review, or if you go to the next slide, our attempt in eDRM to get it called CARM. We lost the naming war. People call it TAR rather than CAR, but the diagram here still represents a consensus model as to the major steps in a CAR or a CAR or a TAR process. And this model was put together by the organizations that had developed up to that point the TAR tools in use in the eDiscovery space. Jump ahead a little farther. We skip a few years to 2015, and iPro introduced ADD or ADD, the not attention deficit disorder, but rather automated digital discovery with the idea that an e-discovery process ought to look like a factory production line. They weren't the first with this idea by any means, but they were the first to put it all together in one package in the way they did. And that brings us to today. So that's a quick overview of the last 10 plus years. Now, what do we have to look forward to? One, we are going to continue to see more and more automation at every stage of the electronic discovery process. That is, you know, inevitable, unavoidable for many reasons. It's going to make our lives better in many ways. It's going to take away a lot of the headaches we have, help us be more efficient, more cost-effective in what we do. And if we are not cost-effective in what we do, we won't be doing it for much longer. But we're also going to see next more automation between stages. This is one of the pieces of the eDRM diagram that often gets forgotten about, the arrows running in various directions. It's one thing to automate within a stage. It's another thing to move across stages, and that's part of where iPro, for example, is going with their approach, their factory approach, not just automating within, but automating across. And as well, more automation between eDiscovery and everywhere. It's not going to just be what we already see, taking the tools and techniques from eDiscovery and deploying them in other arenas, but automating the connections so that you can more readily feed data right into an eDiscovery process from elsewhere, or tie the processes together without even moving the data, and then go back in the other direction. Just a couple of examples. Where does this take us? Well, a couple of, three things in particular. One, I think we are going to see more and more done with the broader world of data analytics. You can think of TAR and predictive coding as two small subsets of a larger world of data analytics, and we are going to see more and more of that. We are going to see people grapple with and eventually begin to figure out what to do with next, big data. And I don't just mean the way a lot of us use big data within the litigation context, lots of data, but rather lots and lots of data coming at you very quickly, many, many different file types, and you can figure out how many more V's you want to throw on besides volume, velocity, veracity, and variety. But then as well, a return to some things that have been focused on earlier, various forms of decision analyses to help build better workflows into all of this. Now, where does all of this take us? Next slide, and then the slide after that. This is where we can get a little bit worried. Think about what happens if you combine the concepts that drive Uber and Google and Airbnb and put them all together and think about what they do to us. Imagine getting rid of a courtroom and using online dispute resolution capabilities. There are a limited number available today. That's probably going to grow. Imagine getting rid of law firms and lawyers the way we think of them now, not really getting rid of them, but adding to them and to a certain extent displacing them with lawyers who look more like Uber drivers. And then think about what's happening to the Uber drivers in Pittsburgh and what that's going to do to lawyers as well, and the data analytics that folks like Google use to drive all of that. So something to think about and perhaps be a bit worried about moving forward. And next.
Well, thank you, George. That was a bright note.
Of course, I want to leave it on an upbeat, cheerful note.
Yeah, well, it's a wonderful segue into drivers and disruptions, because you just described a huge disruption that may be already on its way. And Doug Austin is going to talk about the evolution of eDiscovery automation. And I just want to do a shout out to Doug and to Rob Robinson over at Cloud9. They're a platinum sponsor of ACEDS. They're a full-throated partner, and we're just absolutely pleased that they've sponsored this seminar. So, Doug?
Thanks, Mary. My portion of the presentation is the only one where you won't hear a bunch of nexts, because I'm actually driving my own slides. So, today I'll be talking about drivers to adopt discovery automation technology and the evolution of that discovery automation technology that's led to its potential as a disruptive innovation within the discovery lifecycle. So, is automation revolutionizing discovery? If it is, what are some of the drivers? Here are the results of one question on the quarterly business confidence survey conducted by Complex Discovery this summer related to top challenges in managing e-discovery requests. As you can see here, concerns about rising volumes of data, budgets, and limited personnel are at the top of the list. In particular, data within organizations is doubling about every 1.2 years, but budgets can't possibly keep pace with that, so it's understandable that practitioners out there would consider discovery automation technology to help address those concerns, as long as the technology is efficient and cost-effective. Another driver, which is an incentive for providers in this market, is the growth of the market itself. What we've seen, especially lately, is an increase in mergers and acquisitions and considerable growth in venture capital investment, which is fueling and has been fueled by announcements of automation capabilities by providers in the market. So, with the challenges of e-discovery more prevalent than ever, it's understandable why practitioners and providers alike would turn to automation technology to address these challenges. Of course, technology-assisted review is the most recognized form of automation, and we'll definitely be discussing TAR quite a bit in this session. But first, I'm going to take some time to talk about a couple of other areas where automation is being evaluated, and at least in some cases, implemented. So in addition to its use for TAR, we're beginning to see machine learning and artificial intelligence technology begin to be applied to other areas that impacted litigation and discovery processes. We're seeing organizations such as Eureka and others begin to address the process of information governance through the use of artificial intelligence. This not only enables organizations to perform data discovery to more effectively manage the explosion of information within their environment by eliminating redundant and obsolete data, but also to make key strategic decisions and even identify issues that might lead to litigation and address them proactively. If you're familiar with the movie Minority Report and the idea of pre-crime to predict crimes before they happen, you could call this pre-case to predict and prevent litigation triggering events. That's one goal, and groups like the Information Governance Initiative have been created to help promote efforts to maximize the use of artificial intelligence to more effectively manage growing volumes of data in organizations. We've even started to see law firms employ the use of artificial intelligence attorneys, and I put the word attorneys in quotes, to perform predictable legal processes such as the Ross platform recently chosen by Baker Hostetler and other firms to provide assistance in bankruptcy matters. Another area where automation is beginning to have a significant impact is with regard to SaaS solutions and self-service automation. One key finding in the Gartner Market Guide for eDiscovery Solutions released back in June is that cloud eDiscovery solutions are gaining momentum in the market with their ease of use and more competitive and straightforward pricing structures. A big component to the ease of use idea is self-service automation to simplify the data and loading processing component, which, as many of you know, has historically been a much more manual process. They say if you want to know where a market is heading, follow the money. If you follow the money in the eDiscovery market, you see that we've begun to see significant venture capital investment in upstart eDiscovery providers such as Logical and Everlaw. And we've also seen the emergence of other providers like ourselves at Cloud9 that embrace the SaaS and self-service model. So what about the established big boys? Well, we've seen some of those larger providers like KCura, iPro, and Thomson Reuters recently announced their own SaaS and automation initiatives. With all those investment dollars flowing towards self-service automation, it's clear that automation capability is beginning to change the market in a big way. So where does eDiscovery technology stand today? Let's take a look at how it's evolved. As discovery requirements have evolved, software to support those requirements has evolved as well. Early on, organizations attempted to use source applications such as Outlook to search through volumes of data to identify potentially responsive ESI. But those solutions were adapted for discovery and were not very effective. Unfortunately, some still use those source applications today to conduct their discovery searches. They're essentially still stuck in first gear. Later on, attorneys began to use applications that were designed for specific tasks within the discovery process. But those products weren't designed to integrate eDiscovery tasks and had to be adapted to do so, requiring data to be moved in and out of applications and increasing the probability of error. Then applications came along that were designed for that integration, but didn't support automation of specific tasks, and they still required considerable manual effort to operate. Fourth generation eDiscovery solutions today are designed for eDiscovery, for task integration, and for task automation to enable data to be automatically and effectively moved through the process, culled and searched quickly and effectively with the latest technology to enable organizations to meet their discovery obligations more cost-effectively. Today, when consumers are considering their technology choices, there are more factors to consider than ever before. Obviously, as always, you have to consider the capability of the software application and whether it provides the required functionality to meet your needs. But these days, you also have to consider whether to buy or rent the application, how flexible the software and vendor are in providing a solution that meets your needs, how the software is delivered to you, and whether it's required to be within your firewall or can be an off-premises solution. So if we were to take a hypothetical client that needs processing, review, and production in a single platform, doesn't want to buy hardware or software, and wants the cost to be as predictable as possible, an appropriate solution for that client could be a complete integrated platform that is SaaS-based, so they don't have to buy that hardware or software, in a subscription plan, so they know what their monthly processing and hosting costs will be. So is automation revolutionizing eDiscovery? Well, one way of looking at revolutionary technology is to call it a disruptive innovation, which, as you can see here, is an innovation that helps create a new market and value network, eventually disrupting an existing market and replacing the market leaders. Often that innovation can take a long time to evolve to the point that it can be considered disruptive. Want an example of a disruptive innovation? Remember these guys? As you probably remember, 12 to 15 years ago, to rent a movie, you typically had to drive to a movie store like Blockbuster, hope that the movie that you wanted to rent was there, and stand in line to rent that movie. Today, a form of automation, the ability to stream movies directly to your desktop or TV via providers like Netflix or Amazon, has matured to the point that it's not only displaced the market leaders, it's actually made those movie rental stores obsolete. So say goodbye to Blockbuster. Interestingly enough, it's not widely known, but Netflix tried twice to interest Blockbuster in acquiring their company. Blockbuster not sold on the emergence of streaming technology, and believing that customers would continue to be satisfied to come to the movie rental stores, chose not to pursue the acquisition of Netflix, and their inability to recognize the emerging disruptive innovation in their industry ultimately caused their downfall. Will any of the automation technologies that we're discussing today someday rise to the level of a disruptive innovation? We'll see. Hopefully by the end of the session, we'll have a better idea of what it will take to get there.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you, Doug. And David, can you hear me?
Hopefully yeah, we didn't save it.
Yeah, I see him on the session, but I don't see that he has audio at this point. Doug, would it be possible if we reorder and perhaps go to Bill Dim's slides and while we reconnect with David?
Sure.
That would be lovely.
Let me fast forward here and...
Okay, everybody close your eyes.
There we go. We're now to the build-in portion of the presentation.
Okay, so I'm going to talk to you about how TAR technologies and our understanding of best practices have evolved over the last several years. If you have the next slide, please. So recall is the percentage of relevant documents that are actually found by the TAR system. So high recall is going to be important for defensibility. And so we need to estimate what recall we've actually achieved. That's going to be very important to be able to defend the result in court. One method that's used is called the direct recall method. To do that, you need to find 400 random relevant documents and then figure out what percentage of those documents would have actually been correctly identified as relevant by the system. Now, the trick there is, well, how do you find 400 random relevant documents when you don't know in advance which documents are relevant? Well, you need to sample random documents from the system or from the full pool of documents, review them, and keep doing it until you found 400 that are actually relevant. So if prevalence is 10%, meaning that 10% of the documents in the population are relevant, you're going to need to review about 4,000 documents in order to find 400 that are relevant so you can measure a recall. If prevalence is just 1%, then you need to review about 40,000 documents in order to find 400 that are relevant. So the size of the sample that's required depends on prevalence. It's not some number you can come up with in advance before you started working with the data. And there can be quite a large burden if prevalence is very low for this particular project. So once we've found those 400 relevant documents, and suppose we say that 300 of those were correctly predicted to be relevant by the system, that tells us that our recall is 75% plus or minus 5%. Meaning we reasonably expect it to the actual recall to be somewhere in the range of between 70% and 80%. Now, several years ago, there were other ideas proposed about how to estimate recall. Some people thought that you could maybe get away with a sample of 800 documents, regardless of what the prevalence is. That was really based on a misunderstanding about the mathematics behind confidence intervals. In reality, when you try to use these other methods, there really is no substantial savings in the amount of document review that you need to do. The other problem is that these other methods can introduce bias because they can sometimes involve reviewing documents in different contexts where you might make somewhat different mistakes or judgments about what's relevant and what is not. In the first three cases, under that heading of bad ideas, you can actually work around that problem if you're clever, but in the last case, the EI recall approach, the bias is completely unavoidable. So there's really just no substantial benefit to using these other approaches and just too much potential for problems, so I'd recommend avoiding them, sticking with direct recall. Now, another measure that we use is precision. Precision is the percentage of documents that are predicted to be relevant that really are relevant. So if we're going to review the documents before producing them in order to check for privileged documents and weed out any non-relevant documents, we want to have high precision in order to not waste a lot of time reviewing documents that are not relevant. So recall is about defensibility and precision is about cost of document review. Now, if you have two systems that you want to compare and determine which one's better, if one reaches higher recall but gets lower precision, you're stuck trying to decide whether or not that means it's better or worse. Now, about 30 years ago, a computer science professor came up with a measure that called the F1 score, which mixes precision and recall together into a single number so you can do those comparisons without that ambiguity. But the F1 score has problems when used in eDiscovery. Next slide for that. So to illustrate the problem, at the core, the problem is that F1 assumes a trade-off between precision and recall, and that trade-off is really not appropriate for eDiscovery. So these graphs here show you two different categorization tasks. The task on the left is fairly easy. The task on the right is very difficult. It's hard to separate responsive from non-responsive documents in the case on the right. The black curves are the precision recall curves. So again, the curve is low on the right because it's a more difficult task. And so for each point on that precision recall curve, I can compute the F1 score, which I've shown in red. Now, if you truly believe that F1 is the right measure of the quality of our results, then when we've got that sorted list of documents and we're trying to decide how many documents we're going to produce from that batch, we should take documents until the F1 score is maximized. So on the case on the left, that means hitting roughly 83% recall. On the case on the right, though, that means hitting 46% recall because that's where F1 is largest. So F1 is saying that in the case on the right, because precision is falling by too much, just give up on trying to reach high recall. But that's really not consistent with what we do in actual court setting. The recall we need to hit is going to be determined by proportionality and the value of the case, things that F1 doesn't know anything about. So the F1 score ends up causing lots of problems when used in research studies where it's used as the metric for comparing things. People have also used it to monitor training progress, so they monitor the F1 score to decide when additional training is no longer worthwhile. But then they're optimizing on the wrong thing because F1 is not really measuring what is relevant for eDiscovery. And we've known about these problems with F1 for about 3 years now. And in spite of that, you still hear people talking about it at various conferences. I mean, F1 is like herpes. It just refuses to go away. Next slide, please. So I want to briefly mention some of the big research projects that have occurred in eDiscovery. TREC is the Text Retrieval Conference. It gathers together academics as well as industry people to work on information retrieval projects and see what they can learn. It used to have a track. It was specifically about eDiscovery. In the early days, it tended to focus on keyword search type tasks, whereas in later years, it focused more on TAR. However, they often used F1 as their metric for measuring success, and so those results are somewhat tainted. EDI did a study with data from Oracle, which was potentially very important. It was a large data set, 1.6 million documents, very realistic because it was from an actual case. And it involved 18 different vendors participating to try to see how well they could do with this data. Unfortunately, very little data has been released about the results. Again, it's been infected with the F1 score. The final one on the list, the TREC Total Recall, is new, just started in 2015. It's not specifically aimed at eDiscovery, but it is being run by Grossman and Cormack, and they've really designed that study to be better suited for eDiscovery. So in that case, they have people aiming for high levels of recall and looking at the cost of achieving those levels of recall. Unfortunately, the summary paper from the 2015 event has not yet been published. Hopefully, it'll be coming out soon so that we can actually have an overview of the results from that. Next slide, please. So these are pretty much all the results we have from the EDI Oracle study. They had them perform three different tasks, finding responsive documents, privileged documents, and hot documents. Unfortunately, they didn't produce the actual F1 score, so we don't know whether the top performing results were vastly better than the bottom ones or just marginally better. Instead, they provided ranking numbers to say which ones did best and which ones did worse. The red cells are the ones that had poor results, green are good results. I want to call your attention to the line with the pink arrow. That team spent $1.5 million doing their production. They reviewed roughly half of the documents with human reviewers. And then take a look at the line with the blue arrow next to it. They spent $46,000. And if you look at their rankings for their F1 scores, they beat the $1.5 million result on every single measure. So you can see from this chart that the amount of money you spend doing a document production with TAR can vary quite a lot. And spending a lot more money does not necessarily get you a better result. Next slide, please. Pre-culling. So one of the motivations for using TAR is that it's supposed to do a better job of hitting high recall than keyword search. But some people have taken the approach of applying keyword search to narrow down the data set before doing TAR. So you might be a little skeptical of that because there's potential to lose a lot of the relevant documents by doing that keyword search culling. The Biomet case actually presented some statistical measurements of how many documents they lost in that pre-culling. And William Weber in a blog post analyzed those results and found that they lost roughly 40% of the relevant documents before they applied TAR. So their recall had to be somewhere below 60%. So you should be a little skeptical of that approach. Next slide, please. So next I'm going to walk you through some animations to describe various TAR workflows and new technologies. And it's going to involve this diagram here. So blue dots are non-relevant documents. Orange dots represent relevant documents. You can think of different, by the way, I refer to this grouping of orange documents as being the monkey, because the upper right corner can be seen as the monkey's head, and the upper left corner the monkey's tail, and then the body and the feet below. So you can envision different regions of this graph as representing different concepts. For example, if you're looking for documents that are giving evidence of evidence destruction, then you might see the monkey's head as being documents referring to shredding documents, and maybe the neck is deleting documents, and maybe the body is deleting emails and so forth. So if we go into the animations, the first thing I'm going to describe is TAR 1.0. And before we get that running, TAR 1.0 is going to have a two-stage process. First stage is to review training documents, which we're going to select randomly in this case. And then the second stage is to review the documents that are actually predicted to be relevant. So if you get that started. So it's randomly selecting documents, trying to figure out where the relevant documents are, and still training. And now it's going to switch over to doing review. So it should be hitting mostly relevant documents at this point. And we're going to let the review run until it hits 75% recall, and then we'll stop. Now, one thing that you can't really see from this visualization is how we make the decision to switch from doing training to doing review. We do that by using something called a control set, where we review a random sample of documents. We set them aside, do not allow the system to learn from those documents. Instead, what we do is we look at the predictions from those documents and see how they improve compared to the tags that we applied manually. And once the predictions stop improving enough to make additional training worthwhile, we quit training and do document review. Now, if we could switch over to TAR 2.0. So TAR 2.0 involves finding at least one relevant document to get it started and then having it make predictions. Early on, the predictions will be pretty terrible. But we review a few of those top scoring documents that were predicted to be relevant. And then we have it update its predictions and then review the next set of top scoring documents and just keep iterating that. So if we could get that started. So it's going to be doing training and review simultaneously. It's not two separate phases. And so you can see it works its way outward, finding relevant documents. It learns as it goes. So if it starts hitting non-relevant documents, it'll switch directions and go somewhere else. And most of your document review is focused on documents that have a high probability of being relevant. So you're spending time focusing on those documents right from the beginning. You're not reviewing a lot of control set documents or a lot of wildly irrelevant documents. So we can go back to the slides, please. So if you want to look at performance for those two different approaches, these graphs here are showing the number of documents that are being reviewed. So you want these bars to be short, as short as possible, ideally. In the case of TAR 1.0, we're talking about the number of control set documents, training documents, and then review documents to hit 75% recall. TAR 1.0 are the gray bars. TAR 2.0 are the blue bars. This is showing seven different tasks. The tasks with high prevalence are on the left, and the tasks with lower prevalence are on the right. The left side, the highest prevalence is 6.9%, and towards the right, the lowest is 0.3%. So towards the left, where prevalence is high, we see the performance is fairly similar for the two different approaches. But as you move to the right, where prevalence is lower, the amount of document review for TAR 1.0 is going to increase because the control set has to get bigger. If you're training with random documents, then that training is going to require a larger number of documents as well. Whereas TAR 2.0, since it's primarily focused on documents that are likely to be relevant, when prevalence is low, there are fewer relevant documents, so there's less document review that you need to do. So it tends to go down as you go to the right. Now, in some cases, you may have a situation where you don't actually have to review all the documents that are going to be produced. Maybe you're not concerned about privileged documents for these particular custodians, or you think you can find all the privileged documents by looking at the senders and recipients or doing keyword search, and you're not concerned that if you produce some non-relevant documents, you're going to expose some other bad act by the company that was not relevant to the case. So in that situation, where we can produce documents without necessarily reviewing them, well, TAR 2.0 doesn't really allow you to do that because training and review are all mixed together, but TAR 1.0 does allow you to do that. So if we can move to the next slide and see how that impacts the amount of document review.
But that is the next slide.
Sorry, I wasn't paying attention. So what we see is on the left side where prevalence is high, the amount of document review for TAR 1.0 has dropped by a lot, but when prevalence, and so it actually ends up being more efficient than TAR 2.0. Whereas towards the right-hand side, because the control set is still large and there's so much training required for TAR 1.0, you're actually better off using TAR 2.0. And so how do you make a decision about which one to use because you don't know what your situation is going to be before you get started? Well, that brings up a newer approach called TAR 3.0. So if we could jump out to the animation. The idea there is that we cluster the documents before we do anything else, and we're going to apply an approach like TAR 2.0 using the centers of the clusters to train. And we know that training is finished when we stop finding cluster centers that are relevant, so we don't need a control set. So if you could get that started. So you'll see that it spreads out and discovers what the monkey looks like much more rapidly. And we don't need to review the documents that are going to be produced, but we're going to have it review them in the animation anyway, just to show that it's actually finding the relevant documents now. And again, we're going to run it until we hit 75% recall. So if we could jump back into the slides again. Now, if we look at the impact on performance here, for the TAR 3.0 method, you typically need to review roughly 200 to 600 cluster centers to train the system, and then you're done. There's no control set. So you can produce documents without reviewing. Now, one thing I have left out here is doing the sampling and review to measure the level of recall that you're achieving. That's going to be the same regardless of which TAR approach you take. The other thing I'll mention is that Grossman and Cormack came out with another alternative to something like TAR 3.0 that they call SCAL that they produced recently. So the bottom line is that the amount of document review you have to do to get an acceptable production can vary quite a lot depending on the circumstances and whether or not you take the right approach. And there are new technologies coming out, so you should pay attention to how things are evolving. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill. And David, did you have a question?
I did, actually, Mary. You know, we always hear these benchmarks, as in, you shouldn't do TAR unless you've got X number of documents, and you should have perhaps 90% confidence. I was wondering what Bill thought, if any of those benchmarks really means anything, or is this really case-specific?
It's really hard to come out with some big global statement about what size data set you need to make TAR worthwhile. You know, one of the biggest questions is, are you going to need to make a recall measurement to justify your result? And if you are going to make that recall measurement, the number of documents you have to review for that measurement is going to depend a lot on prevalence. So if prevalence is low, it's going to, you know, if you have to review 40,000 documents to measure your recall, then it's not worthwhile if the data set's small. On the other hand, if prevalence is higher, then it can be okay in smaller data sets. So it really depends a lot on the circumstances, and also, you know, the issue of whether or not you're going to review documents that are going to be produced is a factor as well. So there are just several different factors that come into it, depending on the details of the case. It's hard to say anything that's really globally true.
Great, thanks.
Okay. Doug, can you bring us back to David's section? That's 27.
Thank you very much, Doug and Mary. That was clearly an example of mouth in gear, brain in neutral, because I was enjoying Doug's presentation going on, and then I'm like, uh-oh, they can't hear me. So thank you very much, Bill, for jumping in and pivoting and changing the order there.
So, this is eDiscovery Day, and of course, in eDiscovery, if something is going to go wrong, it'll go wrong right in the middle, and we're all about adaptation. So right now, we're going to have David Horrigan talk about what is the judicial acceptance, and what about attorneys? How are we doing with technology-assisted review in eDiscovery? David?
Thanks a lot, Mary. The quick question is, since the DeSilva Moore decision in 2012, we've gone a long way. Doug, if we can go on to the next slide, there's an outline of some of the things we're going to be discussing. First is the foreshadowing in Judge Peck's Beyond Search article from late 2011. We'll talk about DeSilva Moore and its prodigy. Sometimes we call it the Marbury versus Madison of technology-assisted review. We'll look at some of the global cases, acceptance by the bench, and we'll look at how it's gone internationally with some of the cases, including Pirro and BCA trading. Acceptance by the bar is a good thing to really nail down, because there was an initial hesitance to do this, and a lot of it centered in the certifications that we as lawyers have to make under Federal Rule of Civil Procedure 26G. And the thoughts on technology-assisted review, if you can turn the clock back to the 70s and 80s, when little Mikey in the Life cereal commercial would be sitting there, and his brothers would say, I'm not going to try it, you try it. No, I'm not going to try it. Luckily, we've gotten past those points, but until DeSilva Moore came out, that was really a big, big question. And finally, I'll wrap up with some of the increasing use trends. Now, if we move on to discussing Judge Peck's article that actually came on before DeSilva Moore, you can find it in what at the time was Law Technology News, now Legal Tech News. And Judge Peck goes into copious detail on why he feels there are some weaknesses in keyword searching and why technology-assisted review may be an option. You see a list of cases here, O'Keefe from D.C. going on to Victor Stanley and Maryland into Judge Grimm, and then Judge Peck's other case in William Gross Construction from 2009, all cautioning counsel, on the use of keywords. Now, if you look at that third bullet up there, the 1985 Blair and Marin study, when I was serving as analyst and counsel at 451 Research, this study used to drive me nuts, because I can't tell you how many software vendors would talk to me and say, well, did you know that keyword searching is only 20% accurate? I'm like, no. Blair and Marin did not say that. It was a specific incident, and I think that you can really wrap up Blair and Marin by saying the moral of the study is garbage in, garbage out, as a computer scientist like to say. It was a 1985 study by David Blair of the University of Michigan and Emmy Marin of the University of California at Berkeley, and in this particular instance, keyword searching had a 20% rate, and that is what everyone was going on this recall rate. You're going to miss docs under keyword searching. It's the idea that keyword searching is not inherently bad. It's how keyword searching is used. And one of the points Judge Peck made in the Search Forward article is that lawyers would often get into the trap of saying, oh, well, gee, you know, I can do it on Lexis and Westlaw, so it's got to be fine. The issue this is, Judge Peck says, these are quote-unquote clean databases where it's easy to do keyword searching. The data that you get in a case is rarely going to be that easy, and that's where keyword searching has some challenges. But I think one takeaway is that keyword searching isn't the boogeyman. It can still be used in coordination with technology-assisted review and some of the other tools that we've got in advanced analytics. Now, if we go on to the next slide on the Search Forward article, Judge Peck is comparing some of the issues going on with keywords in these cases versus what we might expect in technology-assisted review. I thought it was interesting that George mentioned earlier in the webinar that they had lost the naming battles. Is it TAR? Is it CAR? Is it even MAR, machine-assisted review? I think George is right. We've all sort of settled upon TAR. But in De Silva Moore, for instance, CAR was used. So, George, you didn't lose that one. But the nomenclature that we're really going with is TAR these days. And if we go on to our next slide, where it's the quote from Judge Peck in De Silva Moore, and it's, this judicial opinion now recognizes that computer-assisted review is an acceptable way to search for relevant DSI in appropriate cases. So this was sort of giving lawyers and their clients the green light by saying, you are not going to get into a Rule 26G problem if you use technology-assisted review and you sign it. And by the way, there are probably a lot of people who don't get caught up in the minutiae of the federal rules. Rule 26G provides that when the lawyer signs on that dotted line, he or she is certifying any number of things, most importantly, that the production is correct and accurate. And there have been cases where lawyers got into a whole lot of trouble. But under Rule 26G, there was the Brandhaven case back in 2013, where one side said, you know, we're going to make the documents available for inspection and at a mutually convenient time, and the court said there was no way that you were going to be able to do that, and they found that to be a 26G violation. So lawyers are legitimately concerned when they sign on that dotted line about whether or not it is a tried and true technology that's going to be able to allow them to make honest statements to the court. And if we move on to our next slide, we're going to see how some of this has gone forward. For those of you who are not familiar with De Silva Moore, it was a 2012 case of Judge Peck's out of the Southern District of New York. And as I said earlier, it's sort of considered the Marbury versus Madison of technology-assisted review. That was the case that opened the floodgates. Shortly thereafter, also in 2012, there was the Global Aerospace case, and that was an important case because, unlike De Silva Moore, where at least part of the time the parties had agreed on TAR use, in Global Aerospace, the court, over a party's objections, ordered the use of TAR. So Global Aerospace, in addition to De Silva Moore, was a key decision. Moving on to the global ones, in Ireland, there's the Quinn matter, and that was a disputed case. Ireland was the second known nation whose courts gave a judicial blessing to technology-assisted review. And then just this year, in Pirro Investments, the United Kingdom joined the party. We should also think about Pirro Investments in tandem with the BCA trading case. Some may know it as the Brown case from the United Kingdom. And I don't want to oversimplify things, but a great way to remember these cases is that Pirro was sort of the United Kingdom's De Silva Moore. That was the first case that allowed it. And then BCA Trading was sort of the United Kingdom's version of Global Aerospace, where the court actually ordered the use of TAR over objections. So all those cases are something that we should really consider when we're talking about TAR and its acceptance by the bench. Doug, if we move on to the next slide, Rio Tinto was an important case because Judge Peck went a little bit beyond what he had done in De Silva Moore when he said, this case, the case law has developed to the point that it is now black letter law that where the producing party wants to utilize TAR for document review, courts will permit it. Now, I have the utmost respect for Judge Peck, and I think most of us do, but I'm not sure that every court would go along with Judge Peck on that. He is far and away above most jurists in the application of technology to law. But nevertheless, this decision carried weight, and it's more of a green light to lawyers and their clients that saying, hey, you know, you're not going to get in trouble for using this. We mentioned the Brown v. BCA trading case. Going on to Hiles v. City of New York, this is an interesting case, another Judge Peck case from this summer. And this was an idea where Judge Peck had the opportunity to go for the next step, and that would be to order a party to use TAR. This one was really important in that Judge Peck did not go as far as some thought he might. You really have to remember whether or not you're a requesting party or a producing party in technology-assisted review. And you know, in the Hiles decision, Judge Peck mentioned the cooperation principles of the Sedona Conference, which many, many judges have signed on to. Nevertheless, you've got to remember that Sedona is not law that courts are bound by. And there have been any number of cases, Biomet, which we discussed earlier today, is one of them, where the courts have mentioned, you know, Sedona is great, but it's not going to carry the weight of law as far as forcing people to cooperate. And, you know, that's a big issue in the federal rules amendments of last year, but that is obviously another topic for another day. If we go on to the next slide, Doug, and this is talking about technology-assisted review and acceptance by both the bench and the bar. The Norton Rose Fulbright data, which was formerly the Fulbright and Jaworski data, it was from their litigation trends report. And each of these trends reports, you saw an increased acceptance and use by clients of technology-assisted review. In the 2015 report, you had over half the respondents saying that they do use predictive coding or technology-assisted review in some cases. And that is, it's a real jump from when you had in 2012 people afraid to use it. And one thing that I put this quote here at the bottom, it was from Judge Peck from a conference recently, far more lawyers use TAR than just the 20 to 30 reported cases. They just aren't suing each other. And this is a great quote because both that 451 and at some of the other data that we have seen, many, many lawyers are using it, but it never gets mentioned in a court opinion, or they don't actually go out and advertise, hey, we're using TAR. It just gets used. So the Norton Rose Fulbright data is showing increased use. Also, in some heavily regulated industries, it's off the chart. Norton Rose Fulbright reported 79% of highly regulated industries such as healthcare were using it, and even in smaller cases, Norton Rose is saying that there were about a third of the companies reported using technology-assisted review on a regular basis. Then if you go on to some Kate Kira Bloomberg data that we put together earlier this year, once again, you're getting over half the respondents, in some cases up to two-thirds, saying that they're using technology-assisted review. So these things really go to show us that we've had a real increase in usage. It's by and large accepted by the courts, not just in the United States, but internationally. And more lawyers are starting to use TAR, even if it doesn't end up in a court decision. So once again, Mary and Doug, thanks for putting this together. It's been great talking to you about it.
Excellent, David. I want to note that when I was in Canada at the Technology and Practice Conference, the show of hands there was about three-quarters of the people there had used TAR on at least one case. So I thought that was also a nice data point for international acceptance as well.
It sure is. It's just becoming so ubiquitous.
It certainly is. And now, Bill Sparrows, you're going to talk about the promise of TAR and the practice of TAR. And we're very much looking forward to your expanded version.
Thank you, Mary. And thanks for the other panelists with whom it's been wonderful to work. And to start, though when many of us started working, we all called it litigation support back then. I've been working, like many of the others here in eDiscovery, for a long time, in my case since 1989. And I've done it, like many of us here, because we love the pursuit. We want to automate as much as possible, but not more. Now, just as Mary said at the beginning, they're offering a caveat, and in that context, kind of an inverted Miranda warning. Let me offer one here, too. To be clear, I'm not saying that TAR does not work, nor am I saying that it hasn't received some level of judicial acceptance, and nor am I saying that it's not being widely used. What I'm saying here is that TAR is not an it. It is an aspiration, a technology-enabled pursuit, but I believe that other people on the panel would agree that whatever the technology we use is, it needs to be informed and guided and overseen by human intelligence. Artificial intelligence needs to be driven by us, the practitioners. Yes, that to some people sounds a little as though it's an admission against insurance. After all, I've been working this long in eDiscovery, working for mostly in-house corporate counsel. But my in-house corporate counsel pay me not to be an evangelist, but rather to be a pragmatist. So I know this, the new rules, whether they're from a year ago or prior, they're here to stay, as is TAR. The question is this: what do we attorneys and paralegals and internal external consultants and vendors do? Well, I'm happy to chat regarding the promise of TAR and the practice of TAR, and I can offer this from my experience. The promise of TAR is promising, and the practice of TAR needs practice. Next, please. How we are where we are as a profession and industry reminds me of where Microsoft was a couple decades ago. Back then, the joke was, how many Microsoft engineers does it take to change a light bulb? The answer was, it takes zero Microsoft engineers to change a light bulb. They just change the standard to dark. So I've been wondering and been fascinated by the question. I'll frame it in the EDRM. Thank you, George, and your co-developers for that. I'll frame it in that context. How many lawyers does it take to identify prospectively relevant data or accumulate prospectively relevant data or process prospectively relevant data or review or produce prospectively relevant data? The answer is, I'm afraid in many ways we're turning the standard to dark. In this context, we think about the discovery process as illuminating facts relevant to the merits. And in the next 10 or 15 minutes, I'll offer three observations that speak to recent events and prospective future events that I hope you'll find interesting and valuable. First, next, please. The first of the three general themes that I'd mention, I won't discuss deeply. I believe that if we take a look back 10 years and forward 10 years, there's a session at 3 o'clock today that will say some things which are going to be key to how we're going to spend the next 2 or 3 years going forward. And that session pertains to Rule 37E, which, from my view, tends to invert the duty of production, compelling the requesting party to know what the requesting party didn't get, and then prove that what the requesting party didn't get was damaging to the requesting party's interests, and therefore compel the producing party to get it right. I'm interested in that. It's a fascinating dynamic, and it's fascinating for a number of reasons. Because of this. Doug, next slide, please.
Bill, we have a question.
Please.
And you may be going to cover this, and the question is, how do you know if you're the requesting party that you get all the information you're entitled to?
A great question. Well, there are a number of ways to get there. Can we hold that for the end, Mary? I'd be happy to. That's a really key question. But I think I'll set it up better in another 5 minutes or so. Fair?
Very good.
Thanks. The question, in part, then, is where is our profession and industry with respect to the disclosure of information? And it reminds me of the old tax scams, although they call them tax shelters. These were designed they were engineered by accountants and lawyers, all of whom have professional duties, and all of them worked very hard to create devices by which taxpayers could avoid paying taxes. The three questions that they asked then, I think, are relevant to discovery today. First, if we make a mistake, will they catch us? Will the requesting party catch us? Secondly, will the requesting party be able to prove anything? They can catch us, but can they prove anything? And third, if the requesting party catches the producing party failing to produce, what then? In the tax context, it is, you know, the taxpayer may need to pay back taxes or pay interest or pay penalty and or go to jail. The question then, as we design discovery, is how much are we at risk? So for the first time in my career, I'm working with some corporate clients who are recognizing that relative to the prior rules, we are because of the new rules, we may be over-engineering how careful we are in meeting our obligations. Again, I'm recommending a 3 o'clock session. Judge Fasciola, I believe, is on that panel. And if you go to the next slide, Doug, I think here's the analysis that you'll see. You'll see that, and this analysis comes from Eric Mandel, really smart lawyer and consultant, who essentially says if you follow the flow of production and the court's analysis, you end up coming to the conclusion, next slide please, that the requesting party is stopped from trying to obtain data absent there being a clear smoking gun. And we'll get to in a moment or two to Mary's question about how we know the gun's smoking. Next slide please. The second key theme I'd recommend you consider going forward is whether the new rules and how courts are interpreting them are essentially perfecting the advantage of asymmetric knowledge. That means to say, if the requesting party asks too much, sometimes that's perceived to be disproportionate, right? And it invites cost shifting to the requesting party. But of course, the requesting party can't possibly know what's too much because the requesting party is not in the producing party space. Conversely, if the requesting party is too vague, then oftentimes that invites this kind of keyword go fish. Now, there's been some interesting cases. I'll just mention their names here because they indicate, in fact, that the requesting party may have a duty to produce or identify search terms. Take a look for Pyle v. Selective Insurance Company of America, Western District of Pennsylvania, September 2016. Next slide, please. The third and final area where I'll focus my comments today pertain to TAR's presumed effectiveness. And I'm going to return to the following three key attributes throughout the next 5 or 7 minutes. Here's what they are. We are presuming TAR to be effective even when we don't know what its purported capabilities are, one. Operating requirements, two. And limitations. Now, I didn't make those up. Those are the same kind of attributes or assessments that the National Academy of Sciences employs when it looks at other forensic sciences and technologies. I'm happy to talk about it here. Next slide. As to whether TAR works, what its capabilities, there's been a schism in our profession, and I think the schism has actually been forgotten. It wasn't long ago that the question that we would face, in fact, Judge Peck raised it in his Silver Moore opinion, was whether Daubert or Federal Rule of Evidence 702 applies to these technologies. That would impose upon the parties in an adversarial proceeding, probably through qualified experts, to assert whether TAR is functional and in what ways it's capable and meets the operating requirements and is not subject to limitations that are relevant. By contrast, our profession is moving more away from reliable tests of technological reliability over to a softer standard, which is, would a party be substantially justified to employ it? If you're interested in learning more about this, I'd recommend that the Daubert and or substantial justification discussion is important to us as we think about how careful producing parties need to be. Judge Waxy and a collaborator wrote the Washburn Law Journal article in 2012 that suggests that, or I think it argues capably, that the Federal Rule of Evidence should apply, that is to say, with respect to technology to assess evidence, that's an area where judges and lawyers dare not tread, to quote Judge Fasciola, and the Federal Rule of Evidence does apply. By contrast, you may look at a Sedona article published in 2012 by Judge Schaefer, which is entitled Defensibility by What Standard, and Judge Schaefer argues that the substantially justified standard is adequate. Next slide, please. Again, back to, and one more, please click. We're back now to what is the valid foundation for these technologies. And in the case of substantially justified, as Doug mentioned moments ago, it's TREC and other anecdotes and endorsements. What is the valid application based upon the substantial justification? It is essentially proportionality. By contrast, the National Academy of Sciences view and the Daubert view would look again at TAR's capabilities, limitations, and operating requirements. So I'm not saying it doesn't work. I'm just saying we don't know where it works or how well it works or whether, in fact, we can validate it's working. Next slide, please. And I'm not alone in this regard. Gartner Group publishes every year a hype cycle. In it, it suggests that machine learning and cognitive experts advisors, which are essentially technology-assisted review, are now at the peak of inflated expectations. So Doug's been careful, or David's been careful about identifying Judge Peck's views. I'm going to offer Judge Peck's views from a slightly different perspective. First, click please. Back in 2012, Judge Peck cited the Gross-McCormack JOLTS study of 2011, and that study asserts that TAR can and does yield more accurate results at a much lower cost than exhaustive manual review. So if that's the Marbury versus Madison case, it's citing out to an article that said TAR can work. Next click. 2016, in the Hiles case, Judge Peck writes, the TAR with continuous active learning is the best and most efficient search tool, but it's not required. Frankly, I'm not sure whether that was the peak of inflated expectations or it's anyway close, because then we go to the next one, please. This is a relatively recently published article in the Daily Business Review in which Judge Peck says the following. TAR is a combination of technology, the people involved, and the workflow process. And my dotted lines indicate I don't know where we are in this. We'll have to see how this plays out. But in some ways, it could be identifying the peak of expectations, because now we know TAR is not an it, it's a process, it's a workflow, it's people, it's humans driving the process. I also think that could be, in the Gartner hype cycle, a way toward enlightenment, because until we recognize how valuable it is to have people infused in the process, we are going to be subject and subordinate to the process, to the machinery. Next slide, please. We can, if we choose, as a profession and an industry, look out to other industries and learn from them. For example, the Presidential Commission recently published a report that says that, in fact, we need to be the AI practitioners can learn from builders of safety-critical systems about how to verify and validate them and manage the risk and communicate with shareholders and stakeholders about that risk. That is toward the slope of enlightenment. In other studies, in fact, click again, please, the Presidential Commission recently published a report that talked about forensic sciences, and it says this: analysis must be based on valid scientific foundations and valid applications and protocols. So what we know is that the rest of the industry has a compelling series of stories to tell us and lessons we can learn as we apply these technologies. Doug, if we're going to click forward a few times pretty quickly to slide 66, please. And next one, please. Let's build this out. Again, I'm not saying that TAR doesn't work. I'm just saying that TAR hasn't been documented with respect to its core capabilities and features and its limitations. I've listed some on this screen. And again, I'm a proponent of using TAR. I just want to make sure my clients know at what points they're at risk and at what points we can hope to derive some meaningful value. Just by way of a simple example, in the capabilities section, I have found that TAR is very capable of handling a particular sweet spot. It frankly is not very, it doesn't add value. It's unnecessary with respect to tangible ideas like septic tanks or windshields. And it's not very helpful with ephemeral concepts like bad faith or marketing or what a duty is. Where I'm finding it helpful is when it deals with tightly clustered similar ideas expressed in different ways. And just by way of example, look through a large collection of documents for people or young or minors. Now I'm going to ask that we actually save some time for discussion here, so including Mary's thoughtful question. So with that, I won't drive into some of the statistical anomalies or weaknesses, I believe, in the proof and evidence. Doug, if you don't mind clicking forward to slide 76, and I'll wind it down. As a teaser, there's some information there, and one more click, please. Well, I guess it's one more, one more, and one up. There we go. So what we have in our industry right now is some sense of loss, I believe, as to whether we are at the expected, are looking at TAR at its inflated expectations, or we're becoming more enlightened about it. My suggestion is the path to enlightenment is more closely associated with Dalbert than it is accepting what the vendors say, which is the substantially justified side. Next click. And we'll finish it out, Doug.
Well, that's great, Bill. Thank you very much. And I've got a bunch of questions lined up here besides the one I had asked you about. And so let's cover them because I think everybody's wondering about some of the things that you've cited. For example, the pipe case, Judge Waxy's article, Judge Schaefer's article, and then the president's report on AI. If we could, the question is, can we include links to those resources when we do our recap and send our thank you note?
I think all of them are on the list of resources, which are at the back end of the PowerPoint stack. I'll make sure.
Look at that. Beautiful, beautiful. So we've got live links in there with all of the various things that have been discussed. So those are kind of like housekeeping questions, and then getting back to the substantive question of how, like, if it's incumbent upon the receiving party, you know, to make a good faith argument that they haven't received everything, how would you know? Bill, we'll start with you, and then we'll ask some of the others as well.
Yeah, I'll go through this very quickly, Mary. There are some objective measures or objective tasks that the requesting party can employ to gauge whether the producing party produced all records. One is objective. Take a look at the dates and the people. If you're identifying individuals who were, let's say, the recipient of a large number of relevant records, but not a custodian who was searched, that's a red flag. Generate a histogram, the number of records, documents you receive over time. If you see conspicuous gaps, another red flag. More importantly, though, I always take a look at the workflow. I want to see if I received important emails that call for follow-up, and we didn't get the follow-up. I'm also looking to make certain that each of the key bureaucratic steps that I presume exist within the other side are being followed. For example, if an invoice has been paid, and it's important to the case, I want to know who approved the payment. There's got to be a paper trail. I'd also then expand our assessment to include other discovery. We tend to isolate the deponents. You know, you were the only one who made the decision, right? Because you didn't produce any records or documents that communicated with others about your decision. People get a little skittish about being the only person in charge of a project that went bad. We then come to learn whether records are relevant. We also hit them with admissions or interrogatories, and just two more. We also are comparing the initial disclosures to the records that were released or initially produced. And if we find that the other side has identified initial disclosure documents that weren't provided to us that were subject to discovery, we scream. And then finally, and this is probably the most important one, although in some contexts it's problematic, it's really how the Zublik line of cases emerged. We have the requesting party oftentimes already has in hand documents. And the question is, did the producing party produce those records or not? That's classic Zublik. Now, just to be clear, when you attend a 3 o'clock session, you're going to learn that maybe because you have the records in hand, you didn't suffer any damages. And so there may not be problems for the producing party, but I'll leave that to the real lawyers in the room.
And you're talking about some pretty significant lawyering. And George, this sounds very familiar to me. It's almost like the inverse of finding the story in your data. You're on the other side and you've received the data. And George, do you have any thoughts on this?
Oh, it's not the inverse. It's still the same thing. It's looking for the story in the data. But there are two ways of looking for the story. One is to look at the data you know about and look for more like that. The other is to look for the things that you don't know you need to know. And I know that sounds rather esoteric. And I'll give two more esoteric examples and then get to a detail or two. One esoteric example, if you were to map out the data on a bell curve and put in the middle of the bell curve the stuff you know the most, and then tail out to the end the data you know the least about or that's least closely tied to anything you're going to find through a TAR process, rather. Think of the stuff you're going to find in the TAR process as what's in the middle. That, for this purpose, is white noise. It's just getting in the way. What you want to try to find are the outliers on the extreme ends, the things that are most different from what you're looking for. A lot of those will be junk, but you can find some gems in there that will suggest the things you didn't even know you needed to know about that are actually quite important. Another way of thinking of it is, you know, we're used to looking in the northern hemisphere at constellations, thinking of them as patterns formed by stars in the sky. If you go to the southern hemisphere, you will see constellations that are the opposite. They're not formed by the stars, they're formed by the gaps in the stars. So again, you're looking for gaps. You're looking for the things you didn't know about. You're looking for the missing pieces. You're looking for the holes in the stars in the sky, a lot of the stuff that Bill was talking about. How do you do it on a more basic level? You can do it on a file-by-file basis. You get an Excel spreadsheet. Look to see if it has indicators the data in the spreadsheet came from somewhere else. If the data in the spreadsheet came from somewhere else, do you have the source for that data as well? Look for gaps in email communications. There's a message from me to Mary, and then a message from Mary to Bill, which is suggested by the message from Bill to David, but we don't actually have the message from Mary to Bill. So look for things like that. You can take a look at information in a very different way and gather large data sets and start to look for pieces and pieces missing, holes and gaps. For that, you may not be able to use what we think of TAR tools. You may need to put that data into SQL or any of a number of other tools and search that way instead.
Bill Spiros here again, just very briefly to follow up on all this. The question was framed from a requesting party's point of view. How does a requesting party essentially come to comfort that the producing party produced everything that the producing party should have? We answered the opposite question as well. How does
I answered that question. That's what I did and do with the other side's data.
Exactly right, George. So it's bidirectional, isn't it? This is all quality assurance from either side's point of perspective.
No, what I mean is I get the data from the other side, and this is what I'm looking for. I'm going to be giving data to the other side. I should be thinking about the same things.
Exactly right.
And I want to build my story. I should think about all those things as well.
Exactly.
Hey, we have another question, and I think this was probably be best for Bill Dim. And Bill, the question is, how do you quality control the TAR software? Not for a particular case, but how do you know the software is working?
This depends a bit on what the TAR process looks like with the software. If you're talking about a TAR 1.0 type process, you would measure a precision recall curve on the control set, and as you train the system, you should see it improve, and you sort of learn by experience whether you're getting a precision recall curve that's as high as you would expect it to be, given the prevalence for the data set and the nature of the task that you're trying to accomplish. If you're doing a TAR 2.0 type workflow, where you're asking the system, give me the documents you think are most likely to be relevant, and reviewing them, and then just turning the crank over and over again, it's a bit harder to tell, just because if the system's working well, you're just reviewing relevant documents all the time. If it's not relevant, not working well, you may have some more non-relevant documents mixed in. But you don't get a big picture view of it in the sense of, you know, if there's some big lump of relevant documents that somehow is missed, would you be able to see it when you're doing that review? And the answer is no. You would have to actually do a sample and see if there's something that's substantial there that's being missed. So it's going to depend a bit on the context, but basically at the end of the day, what you can do is you can do sampling. But what sampling is going to tell you is, have you or have you not missed a large quantity of relevant documents? What it won't tell you is, have you missed an extremely important document where there's only a very small quantity of them? I mean, you can measure large numbers, but you can't measure things that are small but very important. So you can't really guarantee that you will find that smoking gun when there's only one of them, but you can pretty much guarantee that you have not missed some massive wad of relevant documents because a random sample would hit it.
Very good. Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bill. We have another question. If you could please clarify the goal of the law firms and legal departments as opposed to platform developers. Do the law firms and legal departments want the TAR to be assisted by reviewers or reviewers assisted by TAR? Do you have a thought on that, David?
Well, you know, it's a great question, and I am now employed by a software developer, and we always tell everyone that humans are an integral part of any use of technology in the law. There was a case from last year, Lola v. Skadden Arps, that involved whether or not document review is actually the practice of law. It was a Fair Labor Standards Act case, but there was dicta from the judge when the judge said, well, of course, anything a machine can do can't be the practice of law. Technology-assisted review is blurring those lines somewhat, but at least as we sit here in December 2016, humans are an integral part of it, and I think that it's a human-machine partnership. And I don't think anyone, or let me rephrase that, anyone reasonably is arguing that the machines are going to do everything, because they can't. The human involvement is necessary, and it will be for the foreseeable future.
Oh, thank you, David. So we're coming up on the end of our session, and I want to thank everybody who's stayed with us. We will be providing certainly the deck. I want to thank Cloud9 for not only being a platinum sponsor for ACEDS, but Doug Austin and Rob Robinson personally for helping to assemble the presentation and having everything work even with our little glitches here. And we've got our contact information. Everybody will be happy to answer questions if you want to ask individually, or you can send them to us and we'll distribute. So we will have this posted on the Cloud9 site and on the ACED site as well. And we'll include those links inside our thank you note that you can expect over the next couple of days. As our good friend Bill Sparrow said, there are other webinars. If you are binge watching webinars today for eDiscovery Day, I'll be on with George a little later today talking about eDiscovery education and certification options. And there are many other wonderful webinars going on at the eDiscoveryDay.com. You can find more if this has just whetted your appetite. And I want to thank all of you, and happy eDiscovery Day. And thanks to our panelists.